Well, hello and good afternoon, and I thank you all for joining us or watching from elsewhere today. I certainly hope that everybody had a happy and, most importantly, healthy Thanksgiving, and happy holidays to all of you. Today, I want to talk about Virginia's COVID numbers as well as our vaccine preparations. First, our COVID cases continue to rise, and almost every region of the state is seeing sustained community spread. Today, we recorded more than 2,400 new cases and, sadly, 20 additional deaths. Our percent positivity is now at 8.3%. It was around 5% just a few weeks ago, and since we last spoke, we have passed a very sad milestone. More than 400,000 Virginians have died because of COVID-19. Our hospitals are seeing higher numbers of people hospitalized with COVID than they have during this pandemic. Almost 15,000, I'll repeat that, 15,000 Virginians are currently hospitalized today. When we put Virginia's numbers into a national context, we're still doing well, as you see in this New York Times graphic. We're at 28 cases for 100,000 people, lower than 45 other states. But the numbers in states around us, as you can see, the darker the shade, the more numbers, are concerning. North Carolina's seven-day average of cases per 100,000 people is 34. West Virginia is 54. Kentucky is 66. And Tennessee is 69. So in our border communities, people routinely cross state lines to work, shop, and visit their families. What happens in these other states affects us here in Virginia. For example, health officials believe Tennessee's lack of a mask requirement and other restrictions has increased the spread of the virus in neighboring Virginia communities. What we're hearing from our local health districts, especially in Southwest Virginia, is that people are spreading the virus in a variety of settings. Churches, small social gatherings, socializing after work or after school. Health directors tell us that schools and workplaces are largely doing well to follow the requirements, but that the virus is spreading when people gather with friends or coworkers after work or school. They're also seeing the virus spread in family gatherings. In fact, in the Mount Rogers Health District, for example, entire families are already in quarantine after a Thanksgiving exposure. What all of these settings have in common is that people are getting together, often indoors, in places where they feel safe, and they let their guard down. Virginia, you know the truth. If you don't wear a mask and you don't social distance and you think your right to ignore public health advice trumps your neighbor's right to not get infected by you, these cases will just continue going up. It's just selfish. Rights are important, but we also need to emphasize responsibility. And in some parts of the state, if you get this virus and need to go to the hospital, there is not a bed for you near your home. Ballad Health in Southwest Virginia and East Tennessee is sounding the alarm bells, and just today announced that they will stop all elective surgeries in their hospitals. Our hospitals across the Commonwealth have surge plans in place and have a system to monitor their bed capacity. Right now, that capacity exists, but let's not put that to the test. We have the right measures in place. Social gatherings are limited to no more than 25 people, and restaurants have stopped serving alcohol after 10 p.m. We are strengthening enforcement of existing regulations at essential businesses. We just put these measures in place 2 weeks ago, and it takes 2 to 3 weeks of data to see what's working and what isn't. We also are watching for signs of a post-Thanksgiving surge. I continue to closely monitor the numbers, and we'll evaluate whether further mitigation steps are necessary. I ask everyone to remember our shared community responsibility. I appreciate the vast majority of Virginians who understand that we are all in this together and who make sacrifices to help keep themselves and others safe. I especially appreciate the healthcare workers and ICU nurses across this Commonwealth who truly are wearing themselves to the bone to take care of sick people. So please think of them. Now I'd like to turn to some more hopeful news, and that is vaccinations. As you have probably heard, two companies, Pfizer and Moderna, are preparing to roll out their COVID vaccines, and other vaccines are expected in the future. Pfizer and Moderna say that their COVID vaccines are 95% effective in large-scale tests with thousands of volunteers. Both Pfizer and Moderna have applied for emergency use authorization from the Food and Drug Administration. I want to outline for Virginians what to expect in the coming weeks and months. First of all, we have every reason to believe that these vaccinations are safe. Remember that this is a global pandemic, and the best science available worldwide has gone into developing and researching these vaccines. Thousands of scientists, governments, and research labs have worked around the clock all year to bring these vaccines into reality. I've seen this level of cooperation and coordination just once before when I served during Operation Desert Storm. The Virginia Department of Health's vaccination team also has a work group doing an independent review of the vaccine data. So this will back up what we're seeing at the national level. Vaccine science is nothing new. Vaccines have been around since the first smallpox vaccination, which was invented in 1796. Vaccines have reduced or eliminated many deadly diseases, saving millions of lives. Vaccines do not give you COVID-19. Instead, they spur your body to produce antibodies to the disease. As a matter of fact, this vaccine does not use a live or attenuated virus. You will not get COVID from this vaccine. Scientists know how to create vaccines that work and, most importantly, that are safe. As a doctor, I am confident that all protocols have been followed and no corners have been cut, and I expect the FDA review will show that, just as results have already shown in the UK. Second, we fully expect to have enough vaccine to get to everybody, but it will take time, so we all need to be patient. The Federal Centers for Disease Control and Prevention have worked for months to identify groups that need to receive the vaccine early on. And last night, the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices voted to put healthcare workers and residents of long-term care facilities first in line, and this makes sense. Healthcare workers take care of the rest of us, and nursing home residents are some of our most vulnerable people. It's like when you get on an airplane and they tell you that if something goes wrong, to put on your own mask first, so that you can safely help other people. This is the right thing to do, and Virginia will follow the CDC's priorities. Virginia is planning a phased approach which aligns with CDC guidelines. As we get more vaccine, we will be able to prioritize other groups, such as medically vulnerable people. If we don't initially have enough vaccine doses for the entire priority group, we have plans in place for determining who goes first based on medical ethics and protocols created by the Virginia Hospital and Health Association and our Virginia Disaster Medical Advisory Committee. We're setting our priority groups because we expect that most people will want to get vaccinated, and there will be a lot of demand. That is how we eradicate this virus and how we get back to normal, and that is if everyone gets vaccinated. The Virginia Department of Health has been planning for this vaccine for several months, starting in the summer. They've worked with hospitals, long-term care facilities, and providers in the community, and have the systems ready to keep track of this large-scale operation. VDH's vaccination planning has also included members of our Health Equity Working Group to ensure that vaccination distribution is equitable and that it is fair. It's important to remember that VDH, our Virginia Department of Health, has decades of experience with vaccination programs and public health emergency preparedness. They know how to vaccinate people safely and efficiently. VDH has worked to develop a detailed distribution plan that ensures we get vaccines to every part of the Commonwealth and every population fairly and equitably. So here's what we expect to happen next. Assuming the FDA grants Pfizer emergency use request, vaccine doses will ship to the states immediately. This could happen as early as mid-December, just a couple weeks from now. Virginia expects to get about 70,000 doses from Pfizer in the first wave, enough to give 70,000 individuals to get their first dose of the vaccine. This will happen at hospital systems or facilities equipped with ultra-cold storage facilities, which exist in each region of our Commonwealth. Virginia has also partnered with pharmacy chains CVS and Walgreens, as well as other pharmacies and medical offices for vaccine distribution. Both Pfizer and Moderna vaccines require two doses, spaced about 3 weeks apart. Pfizer will ship the second doses in time for those 70,000 people to receive them. While this happens, Moderna and likely other vaccine makers will be going through the same FDA process. So we'll start seeing more vaccine doses being allocated to Virginia. The companies are manufacturing these doses now as we speak, even before final approval, so that distribution can move quickly once that approval comes. When our turn comes, my family and I will have no hesitancy about getting vaccinated. And I strongly encourage every Virginian to get the vaccine. That is our only path to getting back to that near normal, which we often speak about. Now it will take several months to get people vaccinated. For now and for some months to come, we all need to continue doing the things that we know work: wearing a mask in public, washing our hands, staying away from crowds and large groups, and trying as best we can to socialize outside. I can't stress enough how important it is to be careful and to take precautions. You aren't just making an individual decision for yourself. Your decisions impact a lot of other people. And when we have 100 people or 1,000 people thinking they're different from everyone else and don't have to follow the guidelines, that's how we get to these increased case numbers. What we all do affects other people. Especially now, with these vaccines just around the corner, so that we can start to think about an end to this pandemic, it is foolish to take risk. Be more careful than you think you need to be, especially with the holidays coming up. We can get there, but all we have to keep being smart, we have to keep being safe. Now I have a quick update on next steps in our response. First, we are putting an additional $15 million in CARES Act funding to group home settings for people with disabilities to help those homes with COVID expenses. And secondly, I'll be talking with our congressional delegation this evening. and I will strongly urge them to pass a new relief and stimulus package such as what Senator Warner and Congressman Spanberger have proposed. Virginians need help, and Congress should not leave for the holidays without passing a relief package. I also know that we're in the midst of a strange holiday season, and this can be a very stressful time for many people, even in normal times. Our Department of Behavioral Health and Developmental Disabilities has a, quote, warm line for anyone who needs to talk about feelings of anxiety, stress, trauma, or grief. And anyone in Virginia can call or text this line at 877-349-6428. And I'll repeat that, it's 877-349-6428. In closing, the vaccine news is extremely, extremely hopeful. It is the light at the end of this very long and dark tunnel. It is the only way we can solve this health crisis and the resulting economic crisis and get back to a normal way of life. If you want your kids back in school, our small businesses to reopen and thrive, and to go to concerts and entertainment events again, there's only one way to get there. Wear a mask and social distance now, and get a vaccine when the time comes. And I would also encourage all of you, if you haven't already received the flu vaccination, to do that as well. So this is bigger than any single one of us. It is the biggest class project we've ever participated in. We all are responsible to each other, and for the sake of our neighbors, our communities, and our economy, we must continue to do the right thing.